So, first of all, this picture does not show a scientific reconstruction of a Nycticeridae. And this is because the extinct mammalian family of the Nycticeridae is mainly just known from fossilized teeth. The word Nycticeridae derives from the Greek words nycti, which means related to night, and therion, which means wild animal. The genus Nycticerium was first described 1872 by Othniel Charles Marsh, one of the preeminent paleontologists of his time, and well known for first describing many dinosaur genera, but also many other prehistoric animals. Nycticerids were small insectivorous animals of the order Ulipotyphla, but when Marsh described them, he thought they'd be bats, based on similarities of their teeth. So a lot more genera of the Nycticerids had been described, some of them also initially as bats, until 1928, George Gaylord Simpson, also one of the most famous paleontologists of all time, recognized that Nycticerium was not a bat. So he suggested the family Nycticeridae for Nycticerium and a few other small insectivores. The taxonomy of today classifies the Nycticeridae into the suborder Soricomorpha, which also contains moles, shrews and solenodons. Soricomorpha belongs to the order of Ulipotyphla, that also includes hedgehogs and gymnures. This order, in turn, is part of the clade of Lauraceatheria, which we already know from the lecture of Thomas Lehmann. If we now take a look on the inner systematics, there are several subfamilies. Amphidozoterinae, Asionyctinae, Eosauricodontinae, Nycticerinae, Placentidentinae, Praolestinae, and Talpilestinae. Most of them also includes several genera, so all in all, a lot of different Nycticeridae species have been described. Inner systematics might not be the favorite subject of everyone, so I'll just provide you the information here, and you can pause the video to take a more detailed look at some of those different species. But it's really fascinating how many there are described already. But the taxonomy of Nycticerids is not very stable yet. Changes are very likely to happen, and keep in mind, it's not easy to do systematics if you just found teeth of many of these species. So this is not a complete and peer-reviewed overview, but just a little insight. Before we hop from inner systematics to the geological range and distribution, let's take a look on the geological timescale again. At the end of the Mesozoic, we have the Cretaceous period, where dinosaurs were dominant, but mammals and birds also existed. And after the mass extinct at the Cretaceous-Paleogene boundary, 65 million years ago, the Cenozoic started. That's the Cenozoic with the Paleocene, Eocene, Oligocene, and everything afterwards is not necessary for Nycticerids. The oldest fossils of the Nycticeridae are 72 million years old, so they already existed in the late Cretaceous and survived the mass extinct at the Cretaceous-Paleogene boundary, when the dinosaurs died out. But there's one genus, Paranyctoides, which already existed 94 to 66 million years ago. It's maybe an ancestor of the other Nycticerids, and no Nycticerid itself, so I'll ignore this genus in the further presentation. The youngest fossils of this family are around 28 or 23 million years old, which marks the end of the Oligocene. Most of the Nycticerids lived during the Paleocene and Eocene, between 60 and 30 million years ago, and here I created a map with their distribution. These are the locations where fossils were found, and I also color-coded them with the geological epoch. What we see is that they were found in the USA, Canada, Western Europe, Mongolia and China, and the older fossils are from North America and East Asia, and the younger fossils occur more in Europe, where the family survived for the longest time. So what do we know about their natural habitats or way of living? Not much, but they were insectivorous and most likely arboreal. The skeleton parts are telling us this. So it's possible that they lived in forests. Since the climate of the Paleogene was very hot, they maybe lived in tropical-like forests. But I don't want to dig too deep in speculations, so that's about the basic information of nycticebates. For keeping the most important informations of this first part of the video in your head, I made this slide for you. Please take a look at it. And here are a few more pictures of nycticebate fossils. After all of this basic information, we will dive deeper into the topic by looking at a few scientific papers. I will divide them into three chapters. Chapter 1. Juliputhyfla versus Euarchonta. So we already learned that the Nycticeridae belongs to the Juliputhyfla, along with hedgehogs, moles, shrews and so on. But is this really proven? There's a paper by Carly L. Mentz et al. In which the central question appears if Nycticeridae are more related to Euarchonta instead, so primates, codugos and tree shrews. So the teeth and fragmentary jaws show similarities to Juliputhyfla, but postcrania, this is the skeleton except the skull, showed similarities to arboreal Euarchonts. And you might remember, nycticebates are mainly known from teeth or jaw fragments, but there are still a few recorded other bones. And other insectivorous mammals from the Cretaceous and Paleocene, Adapisoriculidae, were also proposed as early Euarchonts due to their postcranial similarities. Armed with the first known dentally associated nycticebate auditory region and postcrania, they went to battle with cladistic analysis of 415 dental, cranial and postcranial characteristics scored for 92 fossil and extant mammalian taxa. They performed the cladistic analysis with maximum parsimony on a character matrix. So the scientists looked at the nycticebate humerus and it
indicates that nycticebates had considerably mobile shoulder and elbow joints.
What they found were synapomorphies to Euarchonts. So I quote their paper again. The presence of these Euarchont-like features in nycticebate postcrania has caused past confusion. Next, they looked at the tarsals. The tarsal bones indicate arboreal capabilities, including three traits proposed as Euarchontan synapomorphies. So again, it looked like in Euarchonts. But the auditory morphology led to another result. All of these characteristics are shared by most Juliputhyphlans, although some may be primitive within Eutheria. So the team came up with three hypotheses about the morphological similarities. First, a close phylogenetic relationship among Euarchontans, nycticebates and Adapisoriculids. Second, separate instances of convergence on arboreal positional behaviors. And third, a primitive state of arboreality in early placentalia that was later lost in most modern placental groups other than Euarchonta. According to their tests, the nycticebates fit into the third hypothesis. In the end, the morphologic analysis led to two clades, Euarchontans, Xenarthrans, Gliras, and some Afrotheria on the one hand, and Juliputhyfla, nycticebates, and other Afrotheria on the other hand, due to synapomorphies. So even with postcranial similarities to arboreal Euarchonts, cladistic analysis said they are closely related to Juliputhyfla. And the Adapisoriculidae, who are no placentalia, just Eutheria but outside the crown clade placentalia, and who also have arboreal traits, develop them in convergent evolution to the Euarchonts. But it's also possible that all three clades of mammals got their postcranial similarities by convergent evolution to their arboreal lifestyle. And not just because the early placentalia were arboreal in general and this lifestyle survived in those three clades.
Adapisauri culidae is found to be outside of crown placentalia. These results suggest that similarities in postcranial morphology among nycticheriids, adapisauri culids, and euarchontids represent separate instances of convergence or primitive retention of climbing capabilities. Welcome to chapter 2, y'all, and the paper with the informations is from J.J. Hooker, you can see it here, and it's about the discovery of a new species of the genus Darbonetus. Darbonetus ziegei was the new discovered species from France, and Darbonetus orbrelongensis the type species. They differ in their dentition, but I want to save you from the detailed information about that and just cite this sentence. D. ziegei shows less reduction of its P2, P3 and M3 than in the more derived type species. Okay, so we can see D. ziegei seems to be a more primitive species, and this is important for the quintessential result of this paper, because Siget thought 1976 that Amphidozoterium and Darbonetus, late European nycticheriid genera, entered Western Europe from outside, because they had no earlier close relatives in Europe. This is the Earth at the beginning of the Oligocene, 34 million years ago. Oh, and I have to throw in that Central Europe is here an isolated island, you can see it. And at the border of Eocene and Oligocene, there was a big extinction event, the Grande Coupure. It is in fact the biggest mass extinction of the Tertiary. Many European mammals died out, and a lot of genera from Asia dispersed and came to Europe. But first of all, Amphidozoterium kailuxi existed already before the Grande Coupure, and the discovery of Darbonetus ziegei, an older species of Darbonetus, shows that the genus already existed in Europe. So the Amphidozoterinae didn't immigrate to the isolated Central European island, they developed there during the Eocene. And they survived the Grande Coupure. Darbonetus orbrelongensis, for example, occurs post-date the Grande Coupure, and this is also why scientists thought they immigrated after the Grande Coupure. But in general, nycticheres dispersed to Europe from North America in the latest Paleocene. The reference for this is Hooker 2015 and Hooker 2018. But there is no evidence to suggest that subsequently any European nycticheres taxa arrived in that continent from elsewhere. Instead, they evolved there as endemics. In his paper, there's also something about taxonomy. He says that Euronyctia, Scrava and Saturninia rigasi of the Nycticherinae are instead Amphidozoterinae. Also interesting is that Hooker ranks nycticheriids into euarchonta in this paper. Remember, it's not determined what they really were, but the bigger amount of sources, also the paper from chapter 1, says Julipotyphler. This is the third paper I will introduce you to, and cause I'm running out of time, I will shorten it to brief results. What the scientists did here was, quite like in chapter 1, a phylogenetic cladistic analysis of 51 North American, European and Asian nycticheriid species, two fossil erinacheomorphs and the outgroup Malestes gobiensis using 66 characters derived from dental morphology using an original character taxon matrix. So it was a phylogenetic analysis with maximum parsimony, and they found out that the oldest nycticheriid fossils were found in North America, but cladograms support an Asian origin of the family, with dispersal into North America by the early Paleocene. The earliest known European nycticheriids are in a clade with North American ones, so as we saw in chapter 2, they dispersed from North America to Europe. Pontifactor bestiola belongs to the genus Vuonycteris. Nycticherinae and Amphidozoterinae, or in terms of genera Leptacodon and Saturninia, aren't monophyletic and require future study and revision. Nycticheres are a link between primitive Eutheria and Julipotyphler. Leptacodon is the most primitive known nycticheriid genus. Most of the Asian endemic nycticharetes form a monophyletic clade resulting from a single migration event of nycticharetes from North America. A single North American nycticharete, Limaconissus habrus, is found in the clade including all late Eocene European taxa. These results suggest that there was considerable interchange between the nycticharete taxa of Europe and North America. And here's a picture of the phylogenetic result as a tree. So we can see that the Asian taxa are very basal, Plagioctenodon is monophyletic, and the rest is a little bit chaotic or polyphyletic, so the systematics doesn't seem to be in their final form yet. But as I said earlier, it's not easy to do this with just the morphology of the teeth. Okay, in case you want to watch individual parts of the video again, because something is not clear, here are timestamps for the topics. And now we hop to the references and some media sources, but before I want to say thank you for watching this video, and I hope you learned something about this mammalian family. And after the references, I'll show directly the YouTube end card, but for the non-YouTube version it will just look like a picture with music.